Last year at Sunny Slope High School, we had a girl on the football team. And she showed up for summer workouts and went through the heat just like the rest of our players. And she was there and she played linebacker and running back, real physical positions. And so during the year, I would like to talk to her and other players like I do, just ask how things are going and what's happening. I would always tell her in coach's language, I can't use the language here at a family mass, but I would tell her, go kick some butt, huh? Because I'd always encourage her to compete against the other guys. And we would talk about different things in life. And in fact, one of the games we were winning towards the end, she went in and ran the ball a couple of times, and the team surrounded her after the game. What great joy to have her on our team. At the banquet, she wrote me a beautiful note and gave it to me. And she said, I really enjoyed all the conversations that we had together. But thank you for not treating me differently. Thank you for not treating me differently. Man, that touched me. Because what she's saying, thank you for not treating me as an outsider or like the other, not one of us. I'm going to keep that note forever because it reminded me of what baptism is all about. In today's second reading, Paul's letter to the Romans, he talks about the beautiful goodness and the challenge of living our baptism. Baptism changes everything for us. We become a new creation, as St. Paul said. That means then we share in Jesus' death, but in his resurrection. That we die to self and live for others. And we are welcomed into the body of Christ, a family. Our brothers and sisters then are everyone who's been baptized. And we are one with them and we have a relationship with them. So baptism calls all of us to let go or die to transitional things in the world and things that are superficial, but to live for the things of heaven. So in other words, prioritize. That's what baptism is all about. Thinking of others, not just ourselves. That's what's making this challenging gospel from Jesus today a little bit more easier to bear. When Jesus says, it's not all just about your own close ones, your personal family. There's a bigger family you're part of. And so when we live in our world, we're not asked then to only be in relationship and care for our close loved ones. That they're first. And that others will need to fend for themselves or figure it out. Or a term that should never come from the lips of a Christian, charity begins at home. That is not the gospel. It is always knowing that not just our close ones, but that we include all our brothers and sisters. That baptism makes us part of a greater and bigger family. The big foundation of the Bible is this, hospitality. The welcoming of friends and strangers, rich and poor. And the Bible reminds all of us, it's not optional. It's not just choosing people that are like us or who are insiders. In the scriptures, in the time of Jesus and in ancient times with Abraham, you never thought about not offering hospitality, no matter who it was. And that's what Christians are called to do through the biblical principle. That hospitality is in welcoming people and encountering people. In today's first reading from 2 Kings, a woman who's pretty much well-to-do with her husband sees a good man named Elisha. He's the prophet after the big Elijah. He's the one of the big ones there. He's the goat of all prophets. But Elisha's following him. And she sees something good in him, but she offers hospitality. Oh, dining, but also she offered lodging and ways of staying there because she sees the holiness, a messenger from God. She then is rewarded in the end when Elisha says, you've received me, and I want you to know next time, this time next year, when I come to see you, you will be with a child, a son, who will take care of you. Jesus commissions his disciples to go out, and he says, be open to hospitality, because whoever welcomes you welcomes me and the Father. Again, the principle hospitality is we see the image of God in every person. Whether we like them or not, whether we think they're living a moral life, whether they're baptized or not, we see the image of God in every human being. If Christians don't do this, then our world is doomed. And yet the challenge is not every Christian understands that or lives it. That's why hospitality is not an option. It's not something you can do when you want, to who you want. The image of God belongs to all. And so Elisha accepts the hospitality of this woman. And the woman is blessed with a child, not because she wins the lottery. She wins good health for the rest of her life because she's cooperated with God and entertained God in the sense of the image of another human being. Jesus accepts the hospitality of people who invite him to dine with them. He eats with all types of people, including sinners and outcasts. But the thing is, we never see Jesus define people as the other or an outsider. Jesus never defines people like that. He defines them as human beings, created in the image of God. And so Christians today, if we understand our baptism, you're part of a bigger family. Not just Americans, but our brothers and sisters live in every country in the world. And anyone who's received the gift of life from God is our brothers and sisters too. And so when we deal with a country now where some Christians are giving really poor modeling, poor behavior, and some of them are even Catholic in our faith, of deciding who is going to be welcome, who are we going to serve, we have the freedom then to reject, and we want to be sure the laws protect us in rejecting people. That's a path that Christians should never go. It should never come in our thought process. That is so not the gospel. When we sit here and we decide who we're going to be hospitable to and not, then what are you doing? You don't know scriptures. You don't know what your baptism calls you to do. And you cannot know God because God is love. And God's image is in every person on the face of the earth, whether you agree with them, whether you like them, whether you think they're an outsider. The greatest thing that Jeanette did for me was to write me a note and the words that I'll carry for the rest of my life. Thank you for not treating me differently. Because not everyone likes girls on boys' football teams. They're not happy about it. And it's too bad I didn't drive her away to keep it only boys. The coaches, the players, did not make her feel like an outsider or the other. She was a Viking. She was one of us. Doesn't that sound like baptism? Isn't that what Christians are supposed to do? And you thought football couldn't teach Christianity anything.